September 18th, 1914. This week, we see the mobile and fast-paced war of the past 6 weeks turning into something never imagined that would prove more sinister and deadly than even the bloodiest battles of the war's beginning. This week began the war in the trenches. I'm Indy Neidell. Welcome to The Great War. At the beginning of the week, the Germans were retreating from the Marne River, having been stopped by the French and the British, but they were far from beaten. While on the Eastern Front, the Austro-Hungarian army was in disarray, retreating from the advancing Russians and seemingly on the verge of collapse. Here's what happened next. On September 13th, there was a meeting in France at General Joseph Joffre's headquarters. Joffre had been in large part responsible for the French disasters of August, but was now getting a lot of credit for the successes of September. The meeting was full of optimism, and what was being discussed was how long it would take to push the Germans back across their own border. Some thought 4 weeks, some thought only three. Once again, people were talking of a war that would be over by Christmas. However, in practical terms, the French were running low on ammunition and were not really able to exploit the German retreat. And though the British were also advancing, they were advancing very slowly. As for the Germans, their brand new chief of staff, Erich Falkenhayn, former Prussian minister of war, was a shot in the arm after his predecessor's nervous collapse. And on September 13th, a bloody month of fighting began as the Germans stopped their retreat on what is one of the best defensive positions in France, the Ain River. The river itself is about 30 meters wide, with flat, low-lying ground stretching out for nearly 2 kilometers on either side with no possibility of concealment. Then there's suddenly a ridge over 100 meters high that levels off to a plateau. The Germans dug in on the north side of the river, a couple of miles from the ridge in a dense forest, but commanding a huge field of fire. That night, the British crossed the river and advanced under a heavy fog. But in the morning, the fog cleared and they were raked with fire and suffered heavy losses. By that morning of September 14th, though, they were established on the northern bank of the Ain. But the troops were in a terrible state. Many hadn't eaten for days and they were soaked, exhausted, and overlooked along the entire line by the German army. Not good. But for the next 4 weeks, they gamely struggled to mount the ridge while the Germans tried to drive them back to the river. Despite thousands of casualties each day on both sides, neither succeeded. Nobody was planning on retreating, though. And on September 14th, 1914, British commander John French gave the first orders for the British to entrench. The Germans were digging in as well, and this was the beginning of trench warfare. See, the Battle of the Ain was the start of something different. The British troops who fought there reported that it was far worse than earlier battles at Mons or Le Cateau, for the simple reason that the battle was so interminably long. And this was very much the nature of the new style of warfare. Battles no longer lasted an afternoon, but could go on uninterrupted for weeks, with artillery barrages lasting for hours and hours. The only way for a man to survive in this war was to make himself invisible, digging himself into the ground. Nobody was really prepared for digging trenches, though. The Germans had spades, which they used to dig small holes for individuals when under artillery fire, but the German equipment was all designed to fit German battle plans, which involved a highly mobile war that could be won in a matter of weeks. They did adapt fairly quickly, though, producing things like rifle grenades and converting things like periscopes and flares for trench warfare. Initially, the trenches were not connected in trench lines and were not particularly deep, but they soon became more and more advanced. Frontline troops would live in underground dorms with storehouses that were built into the wall facing the enemy so they couldn't be shelled. There were communication trenches, backup trenches in case of retreat, eventually a whole network across the entire front with enemies that were often only 100 meters apart. Commander French described the suddenly new situation on September 16th as a stalemate in our favor. But he realized and said even then that in this war, a spade was as useful as a rifle. But stalemate it was in the West, as the battle raged on day after day for a month. The weather was abysmal, and spirits on both sides were at a low. But think how much lower they may have been had they known that the front at which they were fighting would remain virtually unchanged for the next 4 years. In the East, though, it was anything but a stalemate. By September, the Germans realized they had to do something to save Austria-Hungary's bacon. German General Ludendorff went to visit the Austrian Army Chief of Staff, Konrad von Hotzendorf. Now, Konrad was one of the chief architects of the whole war, though he proved to be a terrible leader. But still, he managed to convince Ludendorff that the Austrian army was in such a terrible state because they'd been holding off the Russians so the Germans could tackle the French. Konrad's army was indeed in a terrible state. They'd already lost 500,000 men, 100,000 of them captured, and the army was shutting itself into the fortress of Przemysl on the slopes of the Carpathians with 120,000 men. Now, you'd think it would have collapsed as all the other fortresses did to modern artillery, but the mud was too thick there for the Russians to get artillery into place. The war in the east, though, was really a logistical catastrophe. The spaces to cover were just so large and communications were so awful. And then the autumn rains came and turned everything to mud. There weren't enough railways and there were just too many men to supply. In some units, in fact, only the men in the very front had rifles, and you had to wait until someone was killed before you could get one. But they had men, certainly Russia did, men by the millions. Over in the west, though, one of the main British problems had been that her army was very small compared to those of France or Germany. But Britain had just engaged in one of the most famous advertising campaigns in history. And on September 12th, Britain announced that in only 6 weeks, 478,000 men had volunteered. She had managed to raise an army without any of the mandatory service the Continental armies all used. However, there were some issues with that army. Professional British soldiers despaired of the quality of the new units, going so far as to call them ridiculous and pointing out that it had taken the Germans 40 years of hard work and conscription to create their army. One curiosity of the new recruits is that they were mostly formed of PALS battalions, which were entirely people from the same town or the same profession. Now, this led to a little side note. The British didn't think at the time that without units being geographically mixed, the entire male population of a whole town could be wiped out in a day in a single battle. They would learn this the hard way. Rarely has a mood changed in war as quickly as it did on the Western Front this week in 1914. At the beginning of the week, optimism was high in the British and French armies as the Germans retreated from the Marne. But this was before the armies all reached the Ain. Entrenchment began, and the war of weeks-long, continuous battles and bombardments began. What we see by the end of the week is that the quality and ingenuity of the armies was increasing, even as the death toll mounted. But in spite of all the new advances designed to give an advantage, none was gained by either side, and the war of rapid victories was over for good. The excruciating, stagnant war in the mud had begun on both the Western and Eastern fronts. It would remain in the mud for the next 4 years. If you just joined our show, though, and you wonder how the whole thing started, check out our three Prelude to War specials and our very first episode right here. And for more updates on the events of 100 years ago, follow us on Twitter.